In this video, I would like to talk a bit about scatter plots. And since we already saw several aspects of scatter plots in the general video about plot, I will rather focus on some specific new options that you can use to enhance your scatter plot results and experience. And to start off, again, I load my Münzingen dataset, which is read CSV2 of session 3 Münzingen Fibula dataset, and I specify that row names should be 1 so that the row names end up in the first column here. And what we already seen was that we can plot, for example, the length of the total length of the fibula against the length of the foot of the fibula, and this result in this kind of plot here. And I also showed you that you can, instead of really plotting the points, you can just open a empty plot by specifying that type should equal to n for none. And here now we have a blank plot, blank diagram, where only the axes are already constructed, and this whole space now awaits our interaction. And the first thing we can do is just add the points back in again with the command points, which takes again the coordinates x and y. And when I just do that, you can see here now the points are back. We could also add lines to that plot, and this is kind of the same. And if I do so, I get a crisscross pattern here because the lines are drawn from the first element of the data set to the next element and so forth. So it starts here with the first, goes to the next. So it doesn't make so much sense in this case. Also, it doesn't make so much sense from a content-wise perspective, because there are only these kind of objects that we have here as points, and there is no real reason to assume that a fibula of a certain length would result in a fibula of a certain foot length when we don't know any instance of that, because these two elements can be considered as kind of related, but there is no steps in between that necessarily are there, which is different in case of time series. But still, to use this example to show you how we can make a more useful line plot, we have to at first sort the objects, and then the lines will be produced in the sorted version. So I make a new variable here that I call Münzingen2, and I sort that, or at first I let give me the order of the Münzingen lengths of the fibulas. So these are the lengths, and when I say order, I get the order of the objects. So from the smallest to the biggest lengths, I get the respective the other way around. From the smallest, it's 26. Next smallest would be here the 2, rank 2, order 2, that's the 40, and so on. So from the smallest to the biggest, these is the order within the data set. And I can use this to sort my whole data set according to that order, in a way that I just use the axis on my original data set, which is actually Münzingen, this data set, and I want to access its rows in the order of the length of the column length here. And when I do that, I get a resorted data set, and you can see that the lengths are now in order. And when I put the result into the new variable and I clean the plot again and I draw lines, and this time not from the original variable but from the ordered one, and then we get something that really shows a linear structure also. So in this case, from a data perspective, from a content-wise perspective, it doesn't make so much sense, but it is possible to order stuff there. And I will show you an example where it's making more sense. And for that, I will just copy-paste stuff over here and grab me the calibration curve from the Intcal 13 version. And I read that in as a CSV. It comes in this very specific format, so I have to skip the first 11 lines. I don't have an header here, and I want only have the first three columns that are resulting there. And this now might end up in an error. Let's see if it works now. Ah, okay, it worked. Yesterday when I tried that out, in the Intcal, the radiocarbon server was down, but now we have here a working data set. And when I look into that, you can see that we have here three columns. Sorry, scrolling takes a bit. The first column is representing the BP values, the second one the calibrated BP values, and the third one the uncertainty of that date. So I can use that now to plot this calibration curve. So for example, I just use the plot command. I want my Intcal 13 $V1 as the x-axis, the Intcal 13 $V2 as the y-axis, and I also want to have this of type equals to line, or let's make it type n actually. And then I can say lines of the same variables here. And then I can see here now my calibration curve. We don't see so much structure here, so I rather limit that to xlim should equal to 2000 and 2500. So we get some interesting pattern there. Or let's say the x lim equals to that, and the y lim should equal to something like 2000 and 2600. And if I repeat that, you can see here now some interesting structure going on. And I can add additional lines to that, for example, taking the third column here into consideration. So this is the uncertainty. So I want to have the uncertainty range represented here. So I take that and add the uncertainty on the one hand and make another line. You can see this is now the uncertainty range to the upper limit. But to distinguish this a bit more, probably I will make that line gray and make it dashed, so then we can see that's not the mean but the uncertainty range. So there is no specific rule how you display that, but I would go that way, make that the line type equals to 2, that's dashed line, and set the color to something like dark gray. And making that clean again, you can see now here the upper uncertainty range is now displayed here in this gray dashed line, and we can display the lower one in the same fashion but now subtracting the uncertainty. And now we have here the mean of the calibration curve and the uncertainty range also displayed in that way. So that's one of the use cases where you probably would like to make an empty plot, or you could also have type L here, and then we could skip that part. But still, we need these additional lines commands to draw extra elements into the plot and enhance our scatter plot in that way. Okay, this now four lines. Let's see what we can do in respect to our Münzingen data set to make the plot, to improve the plot there a bit. So I take the plot command back in and specify that the plot type should be blank, and then I like to visualize the points in a different way using different symbols there. So I could say points of the same here and specify a specific symbol, and that could be, this is done by setting this PCH character, for example, to 12. Now you can see that our points here are displayed as small triangles with a crosshair in them. There are other alternatives, so if I say 20, then I have now filled dots here, and this is probably more convenient and looks more nicer. You could also have that already in the original plot command, saying here plot should be 20, but then we don't have to specify type equals to n. So that would result in the same situation, but I take that back here and have that specifically with the points command. The thing is, especially also here, we have to not to use plot and type equals to L here, because plot always constructs a new plot. So we can't add elements with the plots command. We have to use other commands like lines or points, which then add elements to the plot. And I move that out. So now we have the points here again. We could also use this now to make the points, the symbols, according to a different category, for example, according to our fibula scheme. So we have to change this in a way, and to do so we can use the same command, but setting PCH this time not to a fixed value, but something that depends on another variable in our, or another column in our data set. And I could, for example, use the Münzingen fibula scheme, which gives me A, B, and C, but BCH must be a numeric value, so I make that as numeric, and I turn the factor variable into a numeric variable, and you can see now it's 2, 1, 2, 3, and using that, now I can see that we have here points with different symbols representing different classes of objects there. But we can't hardly distinguish which class is represented by which symbol, and to do so we have to add a legend. So legend, I want to put that onto the top left of the plot, and I will use this again, that is consistent to what we're actually plotting. So PCH in the legend should be as numeric as my the fibula scheme. And the thing is, if I just do that here now, I have to specify the legend should equal to that fibula scheme here. And if I do that now, I can see there's a lot of repetition here, because every element from that vector is represented once in that legend, and so we don't need to specify multiple times what kind of symbol A is. To get around that, we can use the unique command, so unique, and this gives us only the unique occurrence of an individual value, and the same goes for the labels, unique. And I clean the plot now, make the points anew, and then put the legend up there. And now we can see that fibula B or fibula type B is represented by these triangles, C by the plus signs, and A by the points, by the circles. So that's kind of the basic structure here. We could not only play around with the different symbols, but for example, we could use also different colors. Let me make a new empty plot and use this point command again, but this time we're not specifying what kind of symbol should be used. We set this symbol to be explicitly 20, which gives us a nice filled circle like we've seen before. And now I use the call command and make that the same way here. I just copy that part. So for each fibula scheme as a numeric vector, I want to have a different color here. And by doing so, we can see here now that we have a color-wise separated data set. And again, we need a legend. And this time it's not PCH, but call, or actually it's fill. Let's start with call. When I do that, I can't see here any specific situation. I could also PCH to 20, like we did in the plot itself. And then I can see that the points are now displayed like they should. So I have to specify here the specific symbol that I used and the specific color scheme that I used in the legend to get the same result here. We could also probably skip this PCH and saying it should be fill and not the color. And then I get something like that, which might be enough to identify the different colors, but to have the legend actually like your display here, you have to use the same specific design commands in the legend like in the actual plot. Okay, now we can use different symbols. We can also use different colors. You could also use something, so this is useful for nominal scaled variables or probably also ordinal scaled variables, but when it comes to metric variables, there might be a better way to representing that. For example, if we want to have for each point also displayed how many coils there are for the individual fibula, I again use the plot command to give me an empty plot, and this command here again to have the individual elements here visible and colored according to the color scheme. And now I could use the number of coils, which is in Münzingen dollar coils here, to come up with a sizing of the individual points in respect to the number of coils that are there. To do so, I add a CX parameter and add the coils in there. So let me reproduce that. And now you can see that the dots are sized according to the different number of coils there. So we have here the possibility to display, make actually a four-dimensional plot, because we have two dimensions in placement of the points, third dimension in respect what kind of color we are choosing, and fourth dimension in respect to how big the plots are. And so with this kind of display, you can already show a lot of information in the same situation. But we still have difficult time to relate the individual points to the actual cases that we have. And for that, it might be nice to plot the text, the names, instead of using points. Or you could also think about having the points and the names on the same plot, but we will just concentrate with displaying text. Points and text are also additive commands, so you can just add a points command and then a text command, and you would have displayed both. But again, let me clean this plot up. And now using the command text to specify, for example, from which grave the individual fibula came. And command, as I said, is text. I need again the coordinates x and y. And this time I also have to set labels. And these labels should come from the Musingen $grave. So here are the individual grave numbers, and I plot that. You can see now that the number of the graves are displayed here in the plot, and we can now identify which grave contains what fibula of what characteristics, and could also work with that. You can see that here's a little bit of overlap in the middle part, and that is probably a good opportunity to show you rescaling of the axis here. And one of the scales that is conventionally used is the logarithmic scale. So this means that smaller differences are made bigger, while here these bigger parts are pressed a bit together, so that we can see more structure here in this cramped part. And to do so, I use again the plot command, but this time I specify log should equal to, and then I can specify which axis, and I want to have both axes in logarithmic scale, so I say x and y. And now we have, you can see here that the scales are not linear any longer, so the distance between 40 and 60, 20, is displayed bigger than the distance between 60 and 80, also 20, and so on and so forth. So the bigger the value gets, the smaller the distance is displayed. And now I can use the same text command here. And you can see this part is now more readable because it's dragged, it's expanded in this middle part here. So this is absolutely a legitimate way of changing the display when this is a better way of displaying your data, but you have to make clear from the axis and also probably from the caption and in the text of an article or of a homework that you used a logarithmic scale and not a Cartesian conventional scale. Logarithmic, to give you better idea what how a logarithmic scale works. Let's say we plot several values here, and when I do that in this way, standardized, so it's the same values from 1 to 10,000 and from 1 to 10,000 here, these 10,000 points, and of course they are linear because when one rises, the other rises to the same amount. But if I change that to log, you can see now we have this kind of curve. So on the smaller parts, the values on the y-axis rise stronger, and the higher the values get, the lesser impact changes in the x-axis has on the y-axis. So that's how a logarithm works. Okay, now I just wanted to end this with showing you some ways of making additional enhancements to the plot. For example, we already saw that we can plot a trend line into our data set, by having the data plotted there and then adding an line, a straight line from a linear model that relates foot length in respect to length from the data set Münsingen, and note the formula notation here that's necessary for making linear models and is also quite handy for other situations. Some commands understand this formula notation, others not. Appline does understand that. And yeah, with that I get a straight line that describes the relationship between both of the variables from a linear model. So that's the best fitting straight line through our data set. But we can also have kind of smoothed line that represents the relationship more on a local way. And for that we can use the Löss algorithm, or let's say the Lois command, which, as the help says, gives you a scatter plot smoothing. And used a local weighted polynomial regression. And what that might mean specifically, we will probably see during the regression video later on. But just to try that out, we use this time the same parameters like in plot. And when I just run that, I can see that I get some values back for x and y values. And I can again plug that into a plot command, so, or an lines command, lines, and I make the resulting line blue, that we can distinguish that from the other one. And now we can see that here's a more smoothed display of the relationship between the variables, not so much in a linear model way, but more describing the trend visible from the data. Because here, for example, the linear model fails to catch up for those elements here, because these elements here very strongly drag the whole line to the upper part, to these outliers here. But if you use this scatterproof smoothing, we get something that fits more actually to the data, is more influenced by the data than by the general linear model, for example. So we see here the line fits very well to the data, and here when we have these outliers here, it becomes a straight line and also describes these data. So when we cannot assume a linear relationship between our data, such a scatterplot smoothing can give us also an idea about the general trend in the data. Another thing that might be interesting is to compare different variables at once in their interaction, and to do so we can use the pairs command, which gives us pairs of variable in a scatterplot, and this also understands the formula notation, but this time we don't give left hand, we only use the right hand side, because we don't describe actually a relationship, but say, okay, give me pairs that comes from, for example, length plus foot length plus coils, and this should come from data equals to Münsingen. And now here are several plots constructed. You can always see the name of the variable here, length, foot length, coils, and then length is plotted against foot length, and we can see this kind of relationship. This is kind of the same plot from a different perspective. Again, length against foot length, but this time length is the y-axis, and here foot length is the x-axis, and here it's the other way around. And with coils, we can also see the relationship between length and coils, and length and foot length, and there is not so much structure probably going on. But with that, you can see a lot of different variables at the same time and their interaction towards each other. Another thing that's might be cool, but not necessarily useful when you plot stuff for a publication or so, is making 3D plots. But it might be nice to impress your colleagues when they watch your screen while you're doing that, or probably you can find a way to implement that into a presentation by making a video. And such a 3D plot can be done in several ways. You can, for example, when it comes to independence from operating system, the most easiest way is probably to use the RGL library that should be available for all operation systems. And from that library there comes a plot 3D command, and if we just put in these three data sets here and say it should be from coming from Münsingen, dollar, again, comma, Münsingen, dollar, again, a comma, and guess what? Oops, Münsingen, dollar here. So now we have not two sets of coordinates, like for example here in plot or so, but we have three sets of coordinates making a 3D plot. And when I run that, here's my little 3D window. Now you can see that we have three axes for length, foot length, and coils is here the third dimension. And I can also interact with this plot by pressing the mouse and turning that around. You can also script that and make some videos from that, or export individual pictures from that to come up in the end with a video, which you can embed in a presentation. But again, it's not probably not so helpful when it comes to printed copies. So you see there's a lot of more options for scatterplot than just using the plot command as such. You can show different dimensions of your data, either by using different kind of styling of the points, different symbols, different colors, size of the points, or you can make a 3D plot literally by using this library RGL. And also there are several ways to visualize the trend in the data, and when sometimes data is too cramped, for example in lower part, you can rescale the axis to make the visualization more understandable for people that are seeing your plots. That's all for now for the scatterplot. We did not went into using ggplot as a library, but as I said before, there will be probably a specific video series on ggplot. See you next time.